So welcome to this very unusual edition of Off the Cuff. Unusual because in this one, instead of talking to someone from outside, we talk amongst ourselves. Prannoy and Dorab, just what we journalists want journalism to be. We just talk amongst ourselves.
Exactly.
But you guys deserve the honor of being at the other end, with me having to do the homework, which I have done.
For once in your life.
For once. Or maybe for once I haven't.
Yeah.
To question the two of you, because you've committed the crime of writing this book, and they are so embarrassed about it, they are not even willing to hold it up. So I have to hold it up for them. That's the story of my life. I have to account for other people's crimes. So Prannoy, let me start with you. Yogendra Yadav, our mutual friend, he said that 7 PhDs can come out of this book. Now, what PhDs would these be?
Well, actually, I thought that comment was the most rewarding of any comment that after writing a book. Because he's India's finest cephalologist, including us. He's much better. And we learned a lot from him over the years. And he called it a seminal contribution to election studies, and that 7 PhDs can come out of it. From him, that just meant everything. And he helped a lot in an earlier draft, you know, correcting nuances and really, really good.
So will you count some ideas which you think, 7 PhDs is a jumla. But,
right.
but there is a reality behind it.
You mean only seven?
In the sense that, can you think of some ideas which need elaboration, which people could now research further?
Well, one of the, I think, major findings in this book, and other people have worked on it before, but I think we've taken it to another level, is that there are 21 million women in India who are over 18, eligible to vote, but are not allowed to vote because they're not on the electoral rolls. 21 million women. That is more than 30,000 women per constituency. And of course, there's this great north-south divide. In the south, women are registered properly on the electoral rolls. It's almost 100%. In the north, many, many women are missing. And the worst, both in percentage terms and in absolute terms, is Uttar Pradesh. 6.8 million women are missing on the rolls of Uttar Pradesh. That works out to 85,000 women per constituency in Uttar Pradesh have the right to vote, but are not allowed to vote because of a technicality of not being on the electoral rolls. Now, we found this. We went to the Election Commission, and they are aware of it, and they really have tried hard. So I think the one PhD is, why are these women not on the electoral rolls? Somebody needs to study it. Somebody needs to rectify it, because it's a travesty of our democracy.
Dorab.
One PhD can come out of something that Shekhar discovered quite fortuitously, and then we found there was a scientific basis for it. You know, if you ever watch elections, hopefully on NDTV, you see leads coming in. Supposing when all the leads, you know, leads come in by rounds, first round, second round, as they count. As leads come in, supposing at the end of all 100% of the leads have come in, say in Maharashtra, 48 constituencies all have come in, and a certain party is winning 25 seats. You would assume that when all the rounds are counted, it will win about the same number of seats. But no, there is a bump, which Shekhar discovered. And then we got it tested by a
statistician. Sometimes you get it right by tukka, as we say.
And
we
discovered. It's called a Shekhar's bump. Bump.
With a P.
Yes. So it's actually somebody could do a lot of work. We've shown 5 or 6 elections, because in every election we keep a track of which constituency reports how many rounds at what time. So we actually know what happened, and we find suddenly, as more and more rounds are counted, a party just moves up and up and up. And there is a statistical reason for it. If you don't understand it, write to Doc Ghosh, who's also listed in the acknowledgements. He'll tell you the statistical reason why it happens. It really is something that deserves much more work.
The next one. You've done all the work.
Another
not I. Yes.
Oh, there's so much. I'm sorry.
So, do women vote like men anymore? Or are they voting differently now?
Absolutely not.
Not.
Women have become increasingly independent in their decision making. 20 years ago, when we used to go to villages, there were like standing next to their husbands and saying, "Jo batayenge, I'll vote like that." Now you ask them, they say, "I talk to him, who's he?" And the husband sits quietly. And all the surveys also show that women vote, women's voting pattern is very different from men. Not only that, they're participating much more than men now. In assembly elections, the turnout of women is higher than the turnout of men. It used to be 20% behind men. It's now gone above men. So women are more active in the electoral process, and especially village women. Rural women turnout is 5% to or 5 to 7% higher than urban turnout. It's a huge, heartwarming a thing to see women queuing up at polling booths. And then there's the tragedy that one out of three turn out and say my name wasn't there. But just the lines of women determine, got their own ideas, and are independently voting for who they want to vote for.
And if this many women were not missing, this gap would be even greater.
Yes, yes, the gap would be even greater. Also, you know, if you think about it, say 30 odd years ago when some of us were around, you know, you heard stories of, at night, the village people gathering together with the sarpanch and the village elders and deciding who to vote for. In a way, the khap panchayat still right. exists to a certain extent.
Right.
In the old days, the sarpanch and the elders in the village decided who you used to vote for. See, even the men voted, in a way, together. The village, then slowly, I think with the coming of media, people have seen wider exposure. So now, not even men, but also women. Everybody is making their own choice. In fact, we met a man in Lucknow this time, where in his household, he was voting for one party, his wife for another party, and his mother for a third party. And they all had reasons. They weren't voting for it because he said, "Look, I'm doing this because this is what this government has done for me." The lady said, the mother voted because the previous government had done something for her, which she felt was very important. And they were not ashamed to show it. So, you know, there is now, in a way, truer democracy.
So, tell me, from a period when we just had waves, usually when you had a big leader, you had a big wave and nothing else mattered. Have we seen our voters move towards the economy sometimes, or are they still stuck with identity?
I think it's a very difficult answer to give. They're both. But the question is, what, as you see votes move from election to election, you see how, you know, what happens to me? The country may be growing at 8%. But you know, if my, I don't have water, I don't have education, I don't have bijli, you know, this matters much more to the voter. What are you doing for me? Don't tell me about the big plans you have. Give it to me. So, you know, they are becoming much more transactional, much more judicious. Of course, there is caste. Of course, there is, you know, charisma. But this is a very, very important thing now in terms of who you vote for.
Pranoy, does anything cut caste?
Just to answer also this question of is there a wave, I think one of the old-fashioned ways of looking at elections, which all of us tend to do, is there a wave this time? Is the vote going to go up hugely? Popular vote used to be very, very important. Almost 70% of seats used to be decided by popular vote. It's no longer that. Only 50% of seats are decided by alliances and 50% by popular vote. It's that much change, and that is a huge change in politics. So when you look at elections, don't just look at the vote. Look at, is there an alliance in this state? How strong is the alliance? And let me tell you, again, another PhD thesis, that when two parties get together, there's a lot of theorizing, oh, will their votes combine? By and large, they always combine plus a boost. Because when there's an alliance, people see, oh, this is a group that can get a higher chance of winning. And it kind of attracts more voters. So you, when you get an alliance, you get the summation of both their votes plus an average of 8%, which is huge. So looking at elections is no longer just at waves. And I've forgotten what your question was.
And
so again, we are talking for another hours, right? We're here for 3 hours?
Yes. How do you see the tussle between economy and identity? Essentially, caste and economy.
I like the way you put it, because it's always a tussle. It's not like all economy or all caste. I mean, there's no situation in which any one caste is 100% for anybody. Even the Jatavs or the Jadavs Yadavs in UP won't be all voting for their particular parties. They're split. So amongst each of them, economy changes. If the economy is not doing well, yes, less Yadavs will vote for you if you're on the ruling front, etc. So both matter. But I think, as Dorab said, it's not the GDP, because GDP can be reflected in growth in cities, in growth in higher income groups, in exporters. But they look at what has happened in my village. Have I got a road? We went to a village, they're not going to vote for the ruling party. Why? Because a small bridge which they wanted for 20 years, no vehicle can go over it, it's so rickety and nobody fixes it. So it's all, I think you said jumla, so that reminds me about actually a leader, and this can be any leader. I don't mean that one or that one. So he went to a village and he said, what are the two things you want? Come on, just tell me. So one of them said, you know, we don't have a medical, we don't have a doctor that comes. He said, just give me 1 minute. Picks up the phone, he said, done, theek hai, chalo. He said, done. What is your second wish? He said, you know, we don't have any mobile connectivity in this area. If I can just get one more.
Shekhar, one more thing I could say about caste. What do I do if I'm a Yadav? And all three candidates are Yadavs. Don't forget that. That often happens.
But there is a Yadav party.
Yeah, but you know, there is, for instance, there are 20, Muslims are 20%. Every candidate is a Muslim. There is no Muslim party. Who do I vote for? So I think other things start mattering. It does, you know, it's not, it is a major factor, but it's not the only factor. And I think it would be fair to say that over a period of time, has become slightly less dominant than it used to be.
But do you also think now waves are less likely or more likely, because now there is so much communication available? You can build a wave. The machinery to build a wave is much more efficient. But is it tougher to build a wave now or easier?
You see, you don't need to build a wave now, because with the split opposition, last time the Modi government got 330 odd seats within alliance, with 38% of the vote.
But the fact is that, say, in UP, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Haryana, Uttarakhand, they had a wave.
Yeah, but you know, a wave still meant that if the next two parties got together, you'd have been beaten. You know, as Benjamin Franklin once said, if you don't hang together, assuredly, you'll hang separately, which is what happened. So the question is, as we were saying earlier, most of the votes, seats were won.
Have any of you ever had Benjamin Franklin? Now you can go home and quote Benjamin Franklin like you read him. That's the reason we have Dorab with us.
Reference to source.
Source. Dorab just makes us both look better.
I thought you said he just makes it up.
that we might do.
No, so you know, earlier you could, to win an election in the big states with more than 10 seats, you got an average of 45% of the vote. Now you're winning the big seats, around 35% of the votes.
Right.
Because the division, which is what those people have learned, so you've got to get together. So we might go back to the old place where you need to get the votes to win, not the division. And many parties actively work to promote divisions amongst their opponents.
Rivals. So let me ask this. Usually, conventional wisdom is that when one side loses, the loser learns more from the defeat than the winner learns from victory. So who learned more in 2014? Has the Congress learned enough from their defeat? In the light of what Dorab said just now, that alliances win.
I would say that the BJP is way ahead of Congress in understanding the importance of alliances, importance of even 4% of the vote or 6% of the vote. They're way far superior in terms of negotiating and forming fronts. The Congress is just, and not only this time, historically living, I think you once said, in the 1970s, and they're just unable to understand how important it is to form an alliance. It often reminds me of that story, the Congress reminds me of that story about three parties who might form an alliance, and there's only one test they have to go through. They have to be harnessed to an electric chair one at a time, and if they clear that, then it's okay. So the first party goes to the electric chair, and person presses the button, bloody not working. They said, "Chalo, you're okay, you can go." So, no, they asked him for, "What's your first wish?" So he said, "I want my leader to become prime minister, sit in the chair," and then he went off, very happy. Second person came and they said, "What's your big wish, last wish?" So he said, "I'd like to hear my campaign song and all that." And okay, they said, "Fine, sit down now, you've had your last wish." Sit down, press the button, didn't work. They said, "The rule is if it doesn't work, you're free to go." So they both went off and formed an alliance. Then the Congress came and they said, "What's your last wish?" And the Congress says, "Last wish, chhad, pehle machine to theek kar."
The point is that I can also tell you what happens with our lives. When we say such things about the BJP, we are trolled mightily by that lot. If we say such things about the Congress party, we are trolled equally mightily. So we are fixed one way or the other.
Actually, it's a big compliment to Congress because they say, "No, we are looking at the bigger picture."
Bigger picture, yes.
So fix the machine.
So in fact, last week I said that Congress party is beginning to look like an NGO. So I got attacked by the Congress party and the NGOs.
Can't win, man. By the way, that was a superb article.
Thank you. So, Dorab, you guys started Sifology. I mean, in India. We'll blame you, right? Although the first reference to Sifology, now that we have Uncle or Auntie Google, I checked, the first article on Sifology was written in 1969 in India. Today's Hindu has something on it. Because 50 years from 1969, so in their 50 years ago column, there is something on Sifology. So you started...
Sifology is a term that came from Oxford with David Butler and his team. And it's from a Greek, the sephos, the pebbles which they used to count votes.
He's been the oldest guest to feature on Walk the Talk.
Really? Wow. Really? He's special. If there was a Nobel Prize for election studies, he would get it.
So you guys brought in the craft of using data to look at elections, not just predicting elections, that's only one part, but attitudes, what people are thinking, what works, what doesn't work. What will be the next thing now, next big thing after data? And don't tell me it will be WhatsApp forwards.
It's a difficult question, let him answer it.
Well, I would say...
You were holding forth on artificial intelligence for somebody on your flight, I believe, today, yes.
No, I was being asked to, but I was like a bit too sleepy to answer. But what we realize that when we do surveys, we do various checks and balances. Who did you vote for last time? And try and match it with the actual voting last time. But there's a lot of people are scared. People play safe. People don't tell you the whole truth. But you ask 20 questions and you can assess where they may be biased actually. So in that, I feel all of us are a little inadequate in analyzing where people are contradicting each other. And deep learning and AI, I think, is the next step towards interpreting opinion poll finding. And they will be much more accurate and much more independent, particularly compared to the two of us. You see, there are 97% of polls get it right. 3% have got it wrong so far.
But you know,
this 3%.
I've been a market researcher all my life. People do contradict themselves, whether soaps, cigarettes, whatever they use. People are not inherently consistent. Right. It's only logic, you know.
Consistent.
You know, if you ask me 40 questions about a soap, you know, I will give you inconsistent answers because that's the way I am. I don't think about it so deeply.
And I think deep learning will bring that out. Much better. We find it tough, but deep learning will take it to a whole new level, and that's coming now. It's already coming.
So please feel free to raise your hands and ask questions. As you know, please tell us your name. Go ahead. Microphone there. This is your conversation. Don't let us do it all amongst ourselves. Go ahead, right. So until the microphone gets there, Prannoy and Dorab both, this question keeps coming up all the time. What works? Does arithmetic work? Does chemistry work? So let me put it differently for cephalologists. Do just the numbers and data work, or there is something else which is more organic, which is more like organic chemistry that we can't easily define, that defies data?
I would say that chemistry and charisma is becoming much less important over the years. We have looked at Indian elections at three phases. The first election was in 52. The first 25 years, 80% of governments were voted back to power. It was pro-incumbency. People had faith in the charisma, in the leadership. The next 25 years, from 77 to 2002, 72% of governments were thrown out of power. So a complete turn from a stars in the eyes, naive, trusting voter to an angry voter. Now you've got a wiser voter. Since 2002, it's 50-50. 50% are voted back, 50% are thrown out. In the angry phase, good, bad, whatever, you were just thrown out. Now, if you've performed on the ground, improved conditions in the village, in my village, in my town, I will vote you back. If you haven't, you're out. Now, what that's beginning to show is that development matters much more than earlier and charisma less. Look at the four or five chief ministers that have been re-elected three times at least. Not people with great charisma or great oratory. Naveen Patnaik, Sheila Dixit, Shivraj Chauhan, Raman Singh. These are not people who are known for their oratory, but they're known for doing things on the ground. So charisma alone will not work, but if you've done a lot of work on the ground, charisma will add.
You know, we used to think that many politicians, the second phase, thought that charisma was not the icing on the cake, but the cake itself. Now they know charisma. Mr. Modi was elected four times. So he delivered, and he was a good orator. It doesn't hurt you to be a good orator, great communicator. Right.
But it's not the
delivery.
But he
was
elected only because he was a good orator.
No, exactly. Give much. That's right. It's the delivery that got him back there, not his oratory. Because the other four examples Prannoy gave, there is not even a semblance of great oratory amongst those people.
Well, if oratory won you elections, then Lalu Yadav would be our prime minister forever. Well,
that's right.
Or Kanhaiya Kumar now. Yes. But it doesn't hurt. After this.
Good evening. My name is Sanjeev Kapoor. A quick question. With all the activities and attempts that the political parties are doing, how much of this Nyay announcement which Congress has made do you think is going to positively impact or not impact the Congress prospects in the coming elections? Question number one. And question number two, $1 million questions. As we speak, based on whatever you have seen, who's going to win? Who's going to win?
Just $1 million for this.
I'll tell you on the 23rd.
Of May.
Of May.
Of May, yes.
So the first question was on this
Nyay scheme.
What people call a freebie. First of all, I think I'm not talking about just this, but the general approach to what is a freebie. We must distinguish between handouts which are welfare oriented and handouts which are just freebies, and not club the two together. Giving somebody a grinder or a television set or a mixer,
mobile phone,
or a mobile phone. These are freebies. But if you give something to people which changes their life, like Nitish Kumar gave and Mamata Banerjee gave bicycles to school girls that help them go to school and come back, now that's money just handed out. But that's not a freebie. So it's very important not to just treat every handout as a freebie. If it improves the welfare and the life of the poorest in your society, that is to be applauded and acknowledged and welcomed. And unfortunately, it only happens at election time. It should happen other times as well.
But will this turn the mood?
Hello.
That's his question.
See, I think as Dorab will just be much better explaining this. very, it's wrong to try and assess a mood by gut feel. I'll tell you why. 1% vote swing gives 18 seats to one side and 18 seats less to, that's 36 seats. 3% is over 100 seats. Can you feel 3%? It's not even right to try. As a journalist or a reporter, our thing is to tell the story, give the issues, and data, good, well-conducted opinion polls can give you that 3%. So it would be wrong for me methodologically to answer that question without doing a poll. We are doing polls, but Dorab will explain this a little better on how it's impossible to predict through gut feel. It's a wrong methodologically wrong thing to
do. I can tell you, the usually journalists' gut feel is based on what their driver told them.
You know, if totally. We had guts, working on gut feel, then I think this book wouldn't have been written. This book is all about the lack of gut feel, but the presence of data. You look at data, see what happened. We are looking at historically, of course, but to, you know, I have a very rude comment on these matters. What people ask me, I say, only liars, fools, and politicians know what's going to happen. Nobody else does. So I either got to be a liar, a fool, or a politician say, this is the result on the 23rd of May. Nobody else was. Just too difficult to tell. You know, for instance, let's take Fulwama. Post-Fulwama, can you feel what happened in the guts, in the villages? Who knows? Is it 2%? 2% away? No difference? You know, when you win elections by such small majorities, it is just not. And, you know, particular people who claim to be data scientists, to abandon data and give, you know, I read the same papers as you do. My views no better than yours. I don't know. There are some people sitting at the back, friends of mine who always ask, who's winning? And I give them the same thing. I wish I knew. I don't. I read the same papers as you do, same magazines as you do, watch the same TV shows as you do. How do I know any better? The fact that I've spoken to 40 people, I mean, doesn't make me an expert on 530 constituencies.
No, and we also travel around a lot into villages and we avoid the main towns and go into the Jatav areas, we go into the deepest part. And when you go, you learn stories and you understand whether they're going to vote with each other, whether the Muslims and the Yadavs are going to vote together and the Jatavs are all going to. You learn those sort of factors. But quantitatively, only large scientific opinion polls can give an answer to who's going to win.
And also, I think increasingly voters now, they believe what they want to believe in terms of who they're already going to vote for. So Mr. Modi's voters think Pulwama, Barakot was a wonderful thing. Those who are not Mr. Modi's voters, it's a lot of people, they say sub propaganda.
Very, in the villages, very
in the villages.
Clear. Yeah, very, very vocal.
Very vocal. But you pick up interesting things. For example, I think it was the first time, because I think around sunset time, most Indian villages, the spiritual level goes a little bit higher, right?
India so, at elections is smashed at sunset.
Smashed at sunset at any
and
time.
And so happy to but, see. They get free booze, man. It's but, lovely.
But this was the first time, I think, at least I saw, combined groups of Dalits and Yadavs.
Yes.
All drunk and because they are on one side now. So
all happy.
I mean, you can see that and say vote transfer is taking place. I mean, risk is yours. I'm not saying that. Because tomorrow morning they'll not be drunk.
Happy.
Hi. Good evening. My name is Ambesh and I'm a media executive.
In the microphone.
Yeah.
Please.
So two quick questions. I think off late, we've seen that often telling people what our political leanings are is now become a negative more than ever. How does it affect the job of a pollster? Does it make your life difficult to conduct exit polls and opinion polls? Because, of course, now you can't freely talk about which side you prefer, number one. Number two, can you talk about an election where you saw significant vote swing happen between the previous government and the upcoming government? So which has been the most spectacular vote shift that you've seen in your career? Thank you.
I'm sorry, the first one was, can you repeat the first question?
The first one was nowadays telling what...
But people are shy of telling you they prefer, so how do they answer?
They are probably in the bigger cities. I think in the villages now, you've traveled there, people are quite open about it.
They're
because, you know, they are voting, I don't think it's as bad as it used to be at all.
I think in fact, in the old days, they used to say, why should I tell you? Or you tell me who to vote for. No longer now.
No longer.
Very different now.
It does sometimes take a little time to get them to warm up. You can't just go and say, who are you voting for? You have to have a chat. We did go to a Dalit village recently, and they all said, we are voting BJP and all that. Then we walked around, we had a cup of tea. They're always the most hospitable. And afterwards, suddenly they all started laughing. And we said, why are you laughing? He said, we told you BJP. We just thought you were BJP people. You came in big cars. And none of us are voting for. They had a good laugh at our expense. But you just got to spend a little time. You can't just go and say, who are you voting for? And you can't. And sorry.
If I can answer your second question, that how does the view of the commissioning body, which is NDTV, affect? You see, the person who's participating in exit poll doesn't know who we are. It goes from an agency. So he says, I'm IMRB or I'm Hansa. Our name is not even mentioned. He says he's doing a poll for a news organization. So I don't think that has any impact on what they say.
Dr. Anna, microphone to him. Okay, Prahlad, you ask first, and then we'll get the microphone to him.
Mine is just an observation, which I want you to comment on, which is that how savvy are voters in cities and in villages about the freebie handouts that we were talking about? And that is that, do they realize that somebody has to pay for it and it's not the politicians? It doesn't matter what party is handing out the freebies. That does the man on the ground realize that they're not giving their own money? They're giving the people's money back to the people by not giving them something else which they were supposed to. So how savvy is the Indian voter today in actually understanding that? Or they don't care?
Well, I think they're very, very savvy now. Let me tell you, voters in India are savvier than all of us put together. They discuss politics in the villages much more than we do. They're very aware of grassroots problems. And as far as they're concerned, if it's improving my life and some rich guys who are paying tax, it's their tax money, it's about time they paid for us. And if it's a welfare measure and it's going to change their lives, it does matter to them.
No, but it's one-offs, you know, like if you give away their loans. So the loans are not for life. The loans are only what they've accumulated now. They have to carry on getting loans if they're going to survive. So do they realize that it's just a one-off and that somebody's going to pay for it?
They realize,
and usually it's them.
Yes. They realize all that, but I think all of us are a bit negative towards all that. Oh, we're giving handouts. While we have, India is socialism for the rich, capitalism for the poor. We have the biggest handouts in all kinds of hidden subsidies. But when they get a handout, we say, oh, it's our taxpayer money going.
It's a political tool. I'm talking about using it as a political tool, saying that we will now give you the handout that we promised you.
See, it doesn't, to a society and a poor person, whether it's a political tool or not, if it changes their life, it matters to them.
And if it gets to them.
If it gets to them.
The key is delivery.
Key is delivery, and we have found some appalling findings in our travels in the villages. A widow has to get 1,000 rupees a month. Goes to the bank. It's all electronic now. The bank manager says, oh, a lot of problems. I have to tell headquarters. A little bit later, give me 500 and I'll give you 500. Now, a bank manager seeing a widow and wants 500 from her out of 1,000. You know, that's the way we treat the poor.
And Dorab, there was a film that was made by Mr. Bachchan.
Sorry? Yeah.
There was a film made by Mr. Bachchan exactly on this. Oh. And do you know that all the banks got together and got it banned?
And got it banned?
Yes. By the way, we got them to phone the bank manager while we were in the bank, and this lady was there. And he came on the line kharab ho gaya.
So, Dorab, do you find geographical differences in this? Some states are good at delivery?
Certainly, I think, you know, the southern states particular are much, much better. You know, when we look at the north, we look at UP and Bihar. They are the big brothers.
Corrupt at the top, but at the ground it works.
Enormous, yes.
Yes, that's a good way to put it.
In the north, you know, in UP and Bihar, the infrastructure is so poor. And, you know, it's the government official who's finally responsible for the delivery. they are much more politicized, much more lax, much more corrupt. You know, and there is no one to fight for them. I think in the South there are more and more people, if I don't get my stuff, somebody will get around and scream and shout and rave and rant, and it'll get done. Doesn't get done so much. I think, you know, the levels of education are also relatively lower in the North. So, you know, all this, you know, as you get a more enlightened, educated, as you're more exposed to media, to your rights, I think you rise up a bit more, which has happened in the South, much less so in the North.
Much faster.
Your work obviously is very scientific. You're collecting data. And your work obviously is very scientific. You're collecting data and data, you're analyzing the data.
Yes,
as Mrs. Dorab rightly said that they don't even know who you are. You're giving to an agency. Then why is it that the opinion polls on different channels vary so much? Don't they all do the same job?
Well, you should read the book where you'll find we've given a rating of, without naming the, we had access to 833 polls. We worked out, some agencies tend to get it often right, some agencies rarely get it right. You know, there are some errors which arise from your sample size, your sampling errors, your professionalism, and some just arise because you're just giving out a number. I mean, when you don't give out the sample size, the dates of fieldwork, you often wonder whether it's done the study. In fact, last time in one case, one agency was quoted on two channels with two different numbers. You know, that is a miracle.
So we've tried to point out a way which you can discern a good opinion poll from a bad opinion poll before the forecast, by the sample sizes methodology.
But also, let's bear in mind that in the vast majority of cases, exit polls do get the answer right. Now, the seats are normally out, but what you really want to know is who won. If he won by 30 seats fewer, you're not that bothered, but the other guy wins, then you have a heart attack. So they get this, the winner is almost, if you remove the 2004 election, the India shining election, where everybody got it wrong. The record of exit polls is 94%, which isn't really bad when you think about it.
Hello.
I think.
Hi.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Vijay. I just coming back to your point about.
Please tell us your name first.
My name is Vijay Rao. Just coming back to your point about how in nowadays we're seeing the split of the vote such that 35% of the vote is enough to win you the seat. I mean, setting aside the impracticalities of doing a runoff system, do you still think that a runoff system might be more representative, or the first-past-the-post system still has its merits?
I think a runoff system is not manageable in India. You take 6 weeks to do one election. Now you want a second election for another 6 weeks? It's a great system. The French have it. I think it's a fabulous system that the two top people go into a second round. But, you know, it takes us 1.5 months to do the first round. You know, I mean, we'll only have elections all year round. I think it's a great
In the microphone. Pranay, you have something to add to this?
I would say that the first past the post system, which we inherited from the British, has a lot of inequity in it. And it's not ideal for a big country. For years, the Congress benefited not only from a divided opposition, but from one very important characteristic of the first-past-the-post system. And that is opposition parties whose votes are spread across the country, like the Swatantra was rising. If it's spread across the country, you get very few seats for every percent of vote. You can get 10-15% of the vote. If it's spread across the country, you'll get two seats.
Unlike proportional representation. Like, I hope you know that in Poland, the National Beer Drinkers Party won a couple of seats also. We do fine here.
That's right.
In that system.
So what we have done, Indians, jugaad, inventive ingeniousness, taken the British first-past-the-post system and reinvented it in a beautiful way. We figured out the spreading across doesn't work. So we have parties emerging with concentrated votes, regional parties. Now, what has happened with that? With regional parties, they've gone from 4% to 35% of the vote, 4%, and then they went to 15%, and they got hardly any seats. Now, with 35% concentrated, they're getting 35% of the seats, just like proportional representation. So we've taken first past the post, jugaad, and made it, we call it JFTP, jugaad first past the post, and made it proportional representation. So teach the British a thing or two.
So in fact, now we have about 30 leaders in this country, each one of whom has a vote bank.
Yes.
Which
yes.
can get them seats.
Yes, exactly.
Hello. My name is Madhu Terdar.
Sir, a bit louder.
My name is Madhu Terdar. I am just trying to engage in a little bit of debate about the conclusion what you have arrived at. The rural folk are very intelligent and they believe in the developmental work. I am talking about my own personal experience. I have seen a village or a cluster of villages during the last assembly elections. The sitting MLA had done a wonderful job. Everyone you ask, almost 60 to 70% of that, he is a very nice guy, he has done wonderful work. But eventually, the person who spent about 10 or 12 crores, he won. My own experience is, what happens during the immediate 1 or 2 months before the elections? How many times he has visited where there is a death in the family, or whether he has really attended a marriage and given a photo shoot with the families? How much of actual booze has been distributed in those villages? How many cars they have distributed, they have many hired? I have personally experienced that is
actually... Sir, what
actually,
is the question?
The question is it really the true that the developmental work, the villages are working? Villagers, I have seen, they don't ask for a dam or a rural. They do ask, but nobody, no concerted efforts will be done to achieve that. Finally, they will be compromised with the kind of a money they get or a booze cut. That is my observation. I'll be very happy to have a more clarification on that. Thank you.
I think what we have done is try to look at data across the country, and it tends to show now that sitting MPs or MLAs renominated, by and large, on average, have a 50% chance of winning again. So it's not that they're all thrown out. New candidates have only a 37% chance. And most parties renominate about 67 2/3 of their sitting candidates. So it's not really, maybe it is true in your area, but it's not generally true that no matter what work you've done, you're thrown out. If you've done good work and if you've been visiting, they need to see you. And that is why MPs are now much less important to voters than MLAs and panchayat leaders and municipal leaders. The turnout for assembly elections is much higher than for Lok Sabha elections. The turnout for municipal elections, we national media focus on Lok Sabha, but for the person in the villages and towns, panchayat leaders and MLA elections are much more important. So visibility, contact, not just they come at election time and then disappear into the Lok Sabha and you don't see them for 5 years.
Well, I mean, if you look at a state like DMK, like Tamil Nadu, DMK, ADMK, everybody pays the voters, but one side wins.
Correct. Yeah, exactly.
And one side wins by a landslide. So.
Yeah.
I think that's the point, that everybody pays. So, I mean, there will always be exceptions of the kind you've seen. But in general, the amount of money being spent in elections is obscene. Both officially and unofficially. Officially, there is no cap on party spend. There is a cap on individual spend, which is ridiculous. You know, in Britain, if the Prime Minister takes a helicopter and goes to 3 constituencies, each of those constituencies have to bear 1/3 of the cost of a ride. Here, whoever goes, a minister goes, I mean, anybody who goes, for the government pays, the party does not pay. And the amount of cash that's doled out is phenomenal, phenomenal.
So we have, just to bring up the intellectual level, another genuine PhD in the audience.
No.
Genuine.
No, Sekhar, very kind of you.
Not like Jalalita and some others.
Very kind of you. My location is very controversial because I'm at Tata Institute of Social Sciences. We seem to be a left-leaning, like a citadel. But, you know, in terms of, I'm trying
Anti-national,
to a large extent. But we are very true patriots in the Tagorean sense. In the sense, on the lighter note, Prannoy, I'm told that your maternal grandfather, Paresh Lal Roy, was called father of Indian boxing,
yes.
Right? So what did you learn from him? Did you learn any boxing tricks while analyzing election studies? And I then I will come back to a more substantive issue.
I learned a lot from him. He was a great man. He learned a lot. He said one thing which got me into the school boxing team. But I think I figured I'm much better at Bhangra than boxing.
Yeah, lovely, lovely.
Did he teach you to duck or not?
Duck, yeah, that's
He taught me the straight left and he said, never lose your temper in a fight.
Wonderful.
Then you lose the might. You lose the fight.
Wonderful.
Have you come close to it lately? You had a couple of fights. You've been caught up in a couple of fights. Have you come close to losing your temper lately?
I don't even remember a fight. You see, there's sorry, I'm going on about these anecdotes. Anyway, these two Buddhist monks going along the road and they come to a place where a lot of kada and mud and there's a old lady and she can't cross and the old monk puts her on his back and takes her across and she kicks him and shouts at him, you're hurting this, that, the other, puts her down the other end and they walk on. 2 hours later, the young monk says to the old monk, what's wrong with you? Yeah, she kicked you and cursed you and you just did this and walked off. And the old guy said, are you still carrying that lady? I put her down 2 hours ago. So I don't remember those fights.
So here, Pranay. So now...
This is Pranay Roy's Buddhist avatar.
You know, I'm learning boxing tricks from him. You know, I keep following him. You know, Pranay, last year in the print, I argued rather in a very controversial way, my new work around what I call presidential prime minister. Cut to 2019 elections, I'm looking at my own piece and related work. I'm trying to remind ourselves, you know, both cephalologists and political scientists, to what extent have we ever analyzed the effect of this new emerging trend of presidential prime minister, you know, courtesy media, 24/7, and then, because when we look at, you know, our own surveys, we have never ever factored into a new beast or a new monster that through Jugaad we have created or reinvented. So that's one.
That's a
one
very unbiased.
Yeah, looks like Pranay, looks like. And secondly, Pranay, I need both of your, you know, most systematic response to the work that we have done recently for Election Commission. There we have debunked this idea. The report will be out shortly by Election Commission. Because of the elections, they haven't, you know, come out with the report that we have done the surveys in, you know, Gujarat assembly elections. Because in the election studies, of late, you know, Milan and others, some of us have started talking about a rising cost of elections. India is becoming not just billionaire, but also billionaire democracy. So what is this idea of vote buying, you know? So cut to this, you know, two questions. Sure. Prime Minister, presidency, and the effect of... Because, see, all over, I travel frequently and, you know, regularly across, you know, length and breadth of the country. Every household, they recognize Prime Minister as a president, you know. But not Rahul Gandhi, you know. You know, perhaps Congress guys haven't coined another slogan, Ek Sherni, Solangur, Chikmangalur, Chikmangalur. So they're lacking that spirit, you know, in fighting in terms of the presidential prime minister. Thank you.
I think around the world, with the spread of media, all elections tend to become somewhat presidential. But the question is, we have a large number of presidents. For instance, in Tamil Nadu, M.K. Stalin is the president and Mr. O.P.S. is the president. Then T.R.S. is the president. Then Naveen is... So it's a personality-based election, that's true. Personalities are becoming much more important because we are seeing them so much more easily because of the spread of media. I think that's happening not just in India, around the world. Because you recognize somebody. Many years ago, we didn't recognize anybody. He'll answer the second question. I don't remember it.
Who has the microphone? Please go ahead.
Hi, my name's Nitin Bhatia. Just a question about, you know, the rural voter. Does the rural voter differentiate between an assembly election and a Lok Sabha election in the sense, does he understand that, you know, voting for an, I'm just taking a UP example, BSP and SP coming together may or may not be able to form the government, but voting for a Congress or a BJP, there's a more likely chance that a government will be formed, a more stable government will be formed?
Can I answer the question?
Yeah, please.
I think it's much more likely to understand than an urban voter, that I can tell you.
I think the urban
voter is probably the least interested and the least literate. You know, when you're an MLA, you come to me. I mean, how many of us know who our MLAs here? How many of us know our MPs? Yeah, but you know, I don't see too many hands going up. So my point is that I think it affects his life. He sees the person. like the municipal corporator, comes to his place to ask for his vote. If he has a problem, he can go to him. So, you know, I think he's much more closer.
I can tell you that, you know, increasingly, anybody who's talked to, I mean, there is a stereotype about villages, but okay, in villages, they know more, they can talk more intelligently on politics than most panelists on our TV channels, which is not saying very much, but they actually can. And they will tell you, wo Thakur hai, wo Brahmin hai, wo Bhumihar hai, wo idhar hai, wo udhar hai. They know everything.
Do they vote differently? I mean, would they understand that?
Of course they do.
Very much so. And it shows in their turnout and their participation rates.
You know, Lok Sabha MP, they rarely see because he's got 15 lakh voters. It's a huge place.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Malini. And, you know, in the last several elections, every election has been fought on a certain plank. 2004, India shining, rural distress. 2009 was re-election for Congress, nuclear deal, whatnot. 2014 was anti-corruption, quite clearly. What is the core real issue that both sides are going to go to fight on or go to the people with the electorate with? What is the one core issue that India is going, you know, political parties will have to address as far as India is concerned? Keeping aside the 8% GDP growth or 7%, whatever the number may be. And a related part to that is that given the fact, when I look at media, when I read, consume television or print news, there's such intense polarization. And how much of a role is that polarization going to play when the average Indian goes to vote?
I think good questions. The fact of the matter is that I think we in the national media simplify elections too much, that there's one big issue and this is going to be Modi versus Rahul. It just is nothing like that. It's one really intelligent MLA told us, it's like an exam paper. You have about 10 answers and you've got to score well in all the answers, you just can't do one. So this election, more so than any other election, and it's a trend over time, is not a national election, it's a federation of states election. Each state is totally different from another state. Like what happens in Tamil Nadu is completely different to Orissa, completely different to Andhra, completely different to Karnataka, Bengal. And we kind of say, oh, this is Modi versus Rahul. No, it isn't. For them, their state matters. Assembly matters, local issues matter, and you cannot oversimplify it like we do in the media as one core issue that is going to affect the whole country. It does not happen on the ground, and we must be aware of that. It's not...
The microphone. You know, this is a slight contradiction because when I watch your television channel, the reiteration constantly is that people vote differently for general elections because at the center they think differently. When it comes to the local level, the issues are different. So if it is a general election, then are they not looking at big picture issues? Bijli sadak pani matters, but who's going to bring it to my doorstep? Is the government strong enough? And that's why Mr. Modi did so well in 2014.
That's
because
not why he did well. He did well for a host of reasons.
True, agreed.
Don't trust the media.
No,
sorry,
I don't. I definitely don't.
Except the print. And NDTV.
Not even NDTV, okay.
You know, the government in power normally runs on its record because you can't erase your record. An opposition normally runs on what it plans to do. I mean, Mr. Modi last time, in addition to the Congress corruption, rang on a chedin. Now people lost. How much was delivered? And the Congress is making promises. So they'll have to weigh between the two. I don't think it's, you know, moti baat, you know, is the fact that you've got to run on. If I've been running a government for 10 years or 5 years, I can't tell people to forget it. So I can make new promises, but they will still remember what I did. Similarly, for the new guy, he has to make a promise because there's nothing that he can do. And then the voter has to decide which way he wants to vote.
Hi, Prannoy. It was lovely meeting you at last. I've heard stories from Kaushik, from your Delhi school days. So yeah, I'm a student of Kaushik.
Kaushik
so.
Basu.
So I just had a question. So as Shekhar characterized between identity and economy at the very beginning, the tussle between identity and economy, deciding what the voter will,
So I was just wondering that war or the threat of war, how much important is this vis-a-vis these factors? And of course, it's a topical question for India, but generally, how does one analytically think about this when we are thinking about, so to use a game theoretic language, whether it can be used as a strategic device by political parties also. So I just don't, I'm not particularly talking about India, but generally, how does one think about, you know, whether it will wipe out the effects which Shekhar was mentioning? Thank you.
Difficult question, pass it on to me.
I don't think
you can really analyze the effect. There is time over which effect, any effect wears off. Any freebie you give, for instance, any welfare thing you do, people forget. So, you know, as Harold Wilson once said, another quote, a week is a long time in politics. So something that happens 3 weeks later, people may remember or may not remember. I think it just is too difficult to put a number on what this. All I can say is Fulbawa won't hurt Mr. Modi. Now, the extent which will help him, I have no way to know. There's nothing in it that could hurt him. But whether people know about it, whether they react to it, what they think about it, something will, you know, a large proportion of our voters seem to have made up their minds as to who they're voting for. So it's you know, you're really voting, waiting for the swing voter, the guy who hasn't made up his mind. He's telling, what can I do for you?
So you don't think that this might change their opinions, or threat of war, whatever?
As I said to you, if there were an actual war, it might be a different. Let's look back to a similar case, Kargil. Mr. Vajpayee didn't get more seats. It happened. But it could happen this time the other way. One just doesn't know, because you're assuming it's the only factor. If we were today fight, if on the day of the election we're actually fighting the war, it would be another factor. But if you're not, one doesn't know. The effect is there, it's worn off. One doesn't know. One can only speculate, but it doesn't make sense.
That means you have to maintain a warlike mood for 7 phases of voting.
Touch wood, hope that doesn't. Oh, no,
my colleague,
I mean, there'll
Tripathi.
Be competition from IPL.
That's tough competition.
At least for.
The way ratings. KKR won.
Praveen Tripathi, a genius, my friend, wants to ask a question.
I think she has a microphone, and then after that, yes, ma'am.
Hi, this is Meena.
Speak up.
I'm Meena Sivan. So I'm a chief.
In the microphone.
Yes, I'm a chief data officer, which means after running all the data analytics for credit scoring, we have finally come to terms with we need expression analytics, which is perception analytics for analyzing the people. I just want to ask you, the psephologist, how much of the perceptions and the recency effects matter in the election mode, right? If that is the case, right, Congress may be running the government for 10 years, all that good, bad. Finally, they also have hopes because it's all the recency effects. Does it still matter, or you think people have evolved from just thinking of the recency effects, what happened yesterday or just a few months before election, or this? Keep all the historical trends of how the politicians, political parties have been performing.
I'll blame the audio problem. I couldn't hear and
understand. Oh! Okay. So, recency effect, does it matter?
Recency effect.
Recency effects, does it matter? And the perception management, does it matter? It's not the data. I'm a data scientist myself. I believe it's not the data, it's just how well you manage the perception in the recent months and years. That's all it matters. That's what I think. What do you think?
Actually, I don't agree.
Okay. Let's debate.
No, I dare not debate it, but I think they, the average voter goes beyond jumla. They go beyond just oratory now. They go beyond just promises. They want to see efficient implementation. And in their village, that's what matters. And we, being a little distant, tend to look at all these other factors. But on the ground, I don't have a, nobody's fixed the bridge in my village. Last week they told me that. That's what matters.
But if it matters, they know for the last 10 years Congress did not do the same thing, right? So why are they still hopeful of coming back?
Now, that's a good question. There are two factors that always affect an election vote. One is, it's got to be important to the voter, like the bridge or corruption or some issue that's important, number one. Number two, they have to see one side better than the other at fixing it. You can't just have a very important issue, but both are useless. Like Chor Ramaswamy said to me, we're voting between a pickpocket and a thief. So corruption is never an issue. But if one side, like actually in the Delhi elections, the Aam Aadmi Party stood apart from being apparently a non-corrupt party, while all the others were seen as corrupt. And that became an issue. Although corruption is really important in people's lives, like this bank manager taking half a widow's pension just to give her her money. So, but they go beyond perception, and by the way, they are very clear they don't really trust the media, honestly. We think we have a huge impact, politicians think we have a huge impact. We overestimate the impact of the media on the electorate. They watch everything, they have WhatsApp, this is almost a WhatsApp election. They have Facebook, but they make up their own minds and they know the biases of different channels. So they're not just gullible anymore.
Dorab, you want to add to this?
No, I'm sorry.
So since you asked about recency and people changing their minds, I'll remind you that in 1977, the same electorate that completely rejected Indira Gandhi, in just over 2 years, in the summer of 1980, brought her back. So even the emergency was forgiven. So Indian voter is very quick to figure out that something has changed. So, ma'am, if you ask a question, okay, you do, and
then Tripathi, the question that I have is, how does urban India differ from rural India in the amount of change in voting intentions that happens 6 weeks prior to election versus election? So will you get, let's say, urban India almost right if you did an opinion poll 6 weeks earlier, but rural wrong or vice versa?
I don't know, but I think urban India, I'll get it right because nobody comes to vote. So I'll get it right anyway.
I mean, among the lowest percentage of votes is Malabar Hill.
South Bombay and South Delhi lead. Because Sunday often, and you're having beer on Sunday, I mean, where's the time for voting? This afternoon you sleep. I mean, it's difficult to tell, you know, it's very difficult to tell.
But increasingly you find that villages and cities are voting pretty much similarly now.
That's true, actually.
You know, whenever, you see, we have found one more thing, that most elections, a large number of elections, are what we call landslides. A landslide we define in a very simple manner, where the winning party gets twice as many seats as the second party. So many of the elections are now landslides. In all states, the winning party gets twice as many seats as the
winning. So, there's a very important point that Dora's making. When you, like we all do this exercise, acha, Bihar's, they'll get so many seats, they'll get so many seats, so in UP, so many, and we add them all up. We tend to, what you need to do, if you look at historically, Lok Sabha elections are a combination of a series of landslides in each state, where they counteract each other. So don't go like if there are 30 seats, one party is going to get 18 and the other is going to get 12. No, one will get 25 and the other 5. Then do your addition. It's much more likely you will have landslides under our first-past-the-post system with a divided opposition than these close fights that we tend to do our back-of-the-envelope calculations with.
I think we'll just take
75% of states have landslides. Sorry.
Good evening, this is Shalini Asher. I wanted to ask you that increasingly it's very obvious that the media houses are pro or anti one or the other angle and parties. It's very obvious increasingly. But what I want to ask is how much, this is more directly towards NDTV and the print, how much do you get affected when one phase or one party or one government turns against you?
Nobody turns for me, so I don't know what to say. You answer this.
It's tough, yeah. We are fighting.
Can I say something? I'm not an owner of NDTV. NDTV is probably the only well-known channel that has been harassed by the Congress government and the BJP government. That just shows where NDTV lies. You find me one other major channel that's been harassed by both governments.
And about the print, I will tell you, perhaps the only ones who get trolled by both.
Both sides.
I mean, if it's Friday, it must be the BJP. If it's Saturday, it must be the Congress. So in fact, in our office, I usually have a banner that says, the left thinks we are right, the right thinks we are left. So we must be doing something right.
Coral, I want to add, want to ask you something. If that is the case, then someone like Niranjan Takle, the guy who broke the lawyer, justice lawyer story, and recently broke something else about the cow, supposedly the cow slaughter, I mean, people getting beaten up because of cow slaughtering or whatever. He's recently broken that, and we don't find it on any of the main media. No one has picked it up.
I'm not aware of this.
See,
I'll check. I don't know.
We'll check now that you say so. But when he did the earlier story, I think there was a lot of follow-up in a lot of the media.
Yes,
true.
On the lawyer story. So obviously, the next one has not come under. But the fact is that today, there is so much media, right? Changing technology, digitization, has brought down entry barriers. So there's a lot of media. So if somebody really has a story, it's impossible to keep that story out. In fact, it's impossible even for the most powerful owners to kill a story. Because if you kill it, somebody will just go out, publish someplace else. If you can't publish someplace else, write a blog. So I think we are past that stage to quite an extent. Raj Nayak and then Deepak. And then, I think, Mansi. Because Pranay has to...
This is off the cuff, but a lot of big news is censored by mainstream media of late.
Like and what?
Like the caravan story that just came out. Or the trucker strike. Trucker strike, I mean, it was there in bits and pieces, but when you had a trucker strike, it would have been a huge issue in any other times. But it wasn't. In fact, a person from didn't even know there was a trucker strike until I met somebody who told me, did you know the trucker strike got over today? Those are the issues. Why is it?
Pranay?
I think it is a worrying trend that stories are suppressed. But fortunately, as Shekhar says, there are alternative media, there's social media, and there's alternative forms of expression. So just the big media houses are not as monopolistic or as they don't dominate as much as they used to, which is a very good thing. Social media in this election is going to play a huge role, and it has a very positive role, but it also has a negative side to it, in the sense that a lot of hate and violence and fake news is spread on social media. And the problem with social media is anonymity. It's both its strongest point, the beauty of the internet is anonymity, and it's also its biggest flaw. Because if you're anonymous, you can't be traced as to spreading hatred and violence. So what we've tried to suggest is that don't touch the anonymity, except in the rarest of rare cases, and people should know that you can be identified in the rarest of rare cases, and that too only by the judicial system, not by the government. So if somebody is spreading violence, he should know that he cannot remain anonymous forever. So the great upside of social media has this dangerous downside, particularly at election time or in communities where there's tension.
Dorab?
No, fine.
Well, I'll just add to that this is a very polarized time. So the media also gets generally divided in two categories. One is chamcha, the other is morcha. So in the middle of that, to do real journalism has become very challenging. Because whatever you do, you're guaranteed to get abused or have your motives questioned by the side that doesn't like it. So ultimately, you have to leave it to the readers, watchers, listeners to figure out who they trust and who
and I think we trust. Also get to bear in mind that all English channels put together are viewed by about 1.5% of the TV audience. So we shouldn't feel that, you know, all of India is watching.
Who knows this better than Raj?
Yeah, that's right. That's right. You know?
Deepak?
This Deepak, yes.
This Deepak.
I don't have a question, but I've known all three of you for many years.
I believe you were in college together.
He was my senior.
As I still am.
So he's our senior too, yes.
So I think all three of you are neither for a political party nor against a political party, and all three of you speak from your heart, right from with your heart. And that is why we admire you and we come to listen to you. I watch NDTV, I read all your articles, Shekhar, and I watch television when Dorab ji is there. So during election time and otherwise. We come because you are friends and you are true people. You write what is needed to be written without fear or favor.
Thank you, Deepak. Thank you. When you get praise, take it.
I was going to say, please delete this when you edit because we are going to get into deep trouble
after. I will get into
you
trouble.
Also, you will get into trouble.
And I've got into trouble in the past.
But that's because you also speak from the heart. So please keep speaking that way. We'll take one more question because Prannoy has to go. I think the young person there, he's been waiting for a long time. And we'll take both these questions together because Prannoy has to leave. And I think before that, you want him to sign some copies.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I guess this is the only time I'm going to get the mic, so I want to ask two questions.
Okay, fine.
The question I want to ask is, how much of a factor will jobs be, or the lack of them be, in swinging this election? And will the government pay for the fact that they have concealed job statistics and data relating to unemployment over the last few months?
Okay, you have a question?
My name is Jaydev. And, of late, there's been an exponential rise in the number of smartphone users and mobile data consumers. So, as journalists who have been covering these elections, like, on the ground, do you think that this is going to be a big factor in last-mile connectivity with a large number of people? Because if you notice now, smartphones and mobile data are being consumed by, like, a huge number amount of the population. So do you think this can play a factor in swinging the election in any direction?
I'll answer the first question. He'll answer your question. Your question was, sorry, what was it? I forget now.
Jobs.
You know, the jobs data was carried in the paper which Shekhar edited for many years. Now, that paper normally doesn't go into villages, into all over the country. So I think it is important, but I don't think. But on the other hand, there is an actual absence of jobs.
Yeah.
That is going to make a difference. You know, when you go to a village, all of a sudden, berozgari is the main problem. A couple of years ago, we were in Punjab, and we saw this man. He's an M-Tech. What's he doing? He's sitting at his brother's shop, where there are six carpenters working for him and his brother. They used to work for his brother alone. Now that he has nothing to do, he sits in the same shop, gets a sick. They split the income. But the question is, that is not employment. There is, people ask often on television, if you're growing at 7.5%, shouldn't there be employment? Let me give a simple quote from an article written by Arvind Panagriya, who was the Niti Aayog head. He said, for every $2.2 million of investment, Reliance Industries creates one job. For every $2.2 million of investment, an organized body called Shlok Exports from Bangalore, which is the largest garment exporter, creates 266 jobs. So the question is, you can put in a lot of investment, but the question is the investment job creating? I would be surprised if in Jamnagar, which is the largest refinery in the world, there are more than 10,000 workers. We need to create jobs, so we need to be, instead of being a demographic dividend, it's going to be a demographic disaster unless we start creating jobs. We need to make things easier for the people to start jobs. If I get 22 people, I've got PF and LTA and everything on my head. I can't get rid of people. If I'm in a seasonal industry, I will do that. Well, we have to help creating jobs in industries that are labor intensive, not that are capital intensive. You answer the second question.
And also, if you don't have a job and you're sitting at home, your self-esteem is zero, You don't care what data somebody throws at you or doesn't throw at you. Exactly. When you don't have a job, you are hurting like hell. And a lot of people tell you that. So nobody comes up and says, look, I know I don't have a job, but I see data that a lot of people have jobs. It doesn't work like that. Somebody asking, answering this question?
Yeah, he asked
smartphones?
Smartphones.
No, I think I somewhat answered that, that social media is extremely important. There are 350 million smartphones in this country now, and nearly 400 million, I think, by the time the elections take place. And everywhere we go in the villages, everybody's using WhatsApp. So this is a WhatsApp election.
WhatsApp, they call it.
WhatsApp.
Any more questions? Manzi, and then we'll close.
Mansi Padke, I work with ThePrint in Mumbai. I quickly two questions. One is, what role are regional parties likely to play this election? Because you said that the benefit of both the parties goes to the alliance plus a swing of up to 8%. And both national parties are scrambling at this point, the BJP better than the Congress. And secondly, the WhatsApp election, most of the fake messages, hate messages are spread on WhatsApp, and the question of anonymity doesn't really arise here because you're always getting it from somebody you know. One person forwards it to another, that person forwards it to somebody else he knows. To what extent do people actually trust this, and to what extent will this impact this election, because it's a new phenomena as such?
Well, I'd say WhatsApp, when you forwarded something, you don't know who it's from because you don't know who they got it from or who they got it from. So you don't know the origin of the creator of the fake news. And that is a major danger, and it's exploited by people who live off hatred, right? And also, and I hate to say this, it happens a lot in America, there's the dark arts of voter suppression. Dark arts of voter suppression where in America, they've made sure that certain kinds of communities and people cannot come out and vote. Now, if you don't want a particular community or women to come out in a particular area, you create tension and violence. So it does affect turnout. So there are a lot of negatives involved. And India's getting smart enough to realize that turnout is important in elections. It's not just swing. And these things do affect. But yes, I do feel social media, by and large, is positive, but anonymity allows too much hatred on it.
You also asked about regional parties. As we said earlier, regional parties have become important. Alliances have become important. So as Prannoy said, the BJP is so much better at forming alliances. Like, there's one case of alliance which is fabulous for the BJP. They had 21 seats in Bihar, one in the bag. They said, we'll fight 17. So they said, we'll give up four of our seats because we want an alliance. Now, you know, which party would do that? I mean, that is what, because the final objective of politics is to win an election, not to lose an election gloriously. So you do what it takes. And this, I've not seen a better example than this, than you said to four of your MPs, you will not fight this time because I want to give the seat to my ally. So I think, you know, that is what building consensus, building an election, winning an election is all about.
So, before we close, I'll ask you the final question. Do you think that with 30, 40 leaders now, each one with a vote bank, it's now, there is no leader in this country who can breach any of these vote banks? I'm asking you.
I tend to agree, yes. They are solid. They are contrary to what media believes. They are additive. When two big leaders come together, their supporters do vote together, and they listen, and the data shows it, and our on the field experience also shows it.
So vote transfer, vote transfer is the reality.
In fact, we don't, you know, we've given some data in the book where we looked at four or five by-elections that have taken place recently, and said these parties got together, say in Gorakhpur, in Fulpur, in Kairana, were the votes additive? They were additive. Not only were they additive, as Prannoy said earlier, there is an extra bump because you think, now I've got a chance to win.
Not bump. Boost. Bump. Boost. This is boost. That's this,
bump. The bump boost. Is different than the boost, sorry. Boost. They get a boost.
You choose your own B word.
Yeah.
Shocking.
Yeah. So it is, regional parties are playing a much more, you know, we are like the United States of Europe. We are not one, we are a, you know, we are a geographical entity. The people are different, the religion is different, the castes are different, the food habits are different, the languages are different. we just became one country. So now we are finding that we have a large number of countries in a federation, and that's how we are voting as a federation.
So to sum up, we can say that era of one-man elections nationally is over, or it hasn't come back yet. But the era of many one-man or one-woman elections is with us to stay.
Absolutely, well put. Yeah.
So in West Bengal, for example, it's for or against Mamta.
Exactly.
In Tamil Nadu now, it's for or against Stalin.
Right.
And it works like that.
Exactly right.
And makes our lives more fun. Yeah. So I got the last word in to impress all of you and them, so that soon I am at the other end. These two are interviewing me, but for that I have to write a book first, which I must tell you is an act of great bravery. So congratulations for having done it, and we've had a great conversation. And thank you very much for watching. Watch this on NDTV and on the print. And remember, these are the two sources of news that you can trust, because we are neither, definitely not chamchas, and definitely not anybody's morchas. So thank you very much for watching. Thank you. Now, you know the drill. We'll have Vinay Ahuja and Ruksh to come and do a little felicitation, and we'll have a quick team picture. And I think Prannoy has to leave, but you know, quickly, if he can sign a few copies, that will be great.
Thank you. I hope you didn't fall asleep. Dr. Roy, I got my first job with you. I don't know.